Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salam ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Amma ba'd. So last week we had discussed the initial victory of the Muslims, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala references this in the Quran. And by the way, inshallah, maybe not next Wednesday, but two Wednesdays from now, we will go over the verses about Surah Ali Imran about Uhud, just as we went over Surah Al-Anfal about Badr. We're going to go over all the verses about Uhud. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ وَعَدَكُمُ اللَّهُ وَلَقَدْ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled his promise on you. SubhanAllah, I can't remember the verse right now. Surah Al Imran, Hafizab, Walaqad Nasarakumullahu. No, that's not it. No, we're talking about Badr, we're talking about Uhud now. We did Badr many months ago. In any case, it'll come to me. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them that as I promised you, I helped you. Right? That as I promised you, I helped you. That Allah Azza wa Jal had promised them. حتى إذا فشلتم وتنازعتم في الأمر وعصيتم من بعد ما أراكم ما تحبون. This is the verse. حتى إذا فشلتم. Then when you yourselves lost your himma, you kind of became lazy, and you began arguing amongst yourselves, and you saw that which you loved. So Allah says, when you were pure and sincere to me, I gave you what I had promised you. But when you yourselves faltered, and you yourselves fell back, and you yourselves became greedy for something, then Allah says, this is when the disaster basically struck. And in the books of Seerah, we learn the details of what happened. And as I said, one of the problems of Uhud, and this is what we're going to face all of today and a little bit of next Wednesday, one of the problems of piecing together Uhud is that we don't have a detailed picture. All we have is one story of Mus'ab, one story of Hamza, one story of this, one story of that, and then we don't have a generic picture of the battle. And therefore, reconstructing Uhud, in my humble experience with the Seerah, is the most difficult task of the whole Seerah. In my humble experience with the Seerah, trying to understand exactly what happened in Uhud, because Uhud is one of the most decisive battles, and it was somewhat of a disaster, and it was very chaotic. So to this day, in my humble opinion, there's a lot of questions about Uhud that maybe we'll never know. Because as I said, put yourselves in the shoes of the victors, put yourselves in the shoes of those who were alive at the end of Uhud. How much would they say? What would they say? They would only say one or two incidents here and there. And then human beings, they don't like to dwell on bad memories. They want to mention good memories more. And so we don't know too much about Uhud. In any case, one of the things that we know, and of course the primary cause of the change of tide, was the fact that when the mushrikun fled, the Sahaba felt complacent enough to let go of their arms, to put them away, and start collecting all of the war booty. And we can imagine, we don't have the details, we can imagine what would be left behind. Most important and the most prized possessions are good weapons. Good weapons are hard to come by, and generally speaking, they are imported from other lands. And anything that is imported is very expensive. The Arabs were not the best of ironsmiths. They were not the best of weapon makers. The Arabs exported back then, not oil, but they exported tanned leather, they exported other goods from the desert, they exported dates, but they would import weapons. So weapons are very expensive, and they lasted a generation, they lasted a long time. Maybe even to the next generation it will be inherited. So weapons is the number one thing. Tents as well. Animals, if the mushrikun fled and left a camel is worth a lot of money. So when they saw this ghanima, when they saw this war booty and the mushrikun had fled, so they discarded their arms and they began collecting to go back to camp and collect again. And we need to understand that the rules of ghanima had not yet been fully finalized. No doubt, some of the rules had come at Badr. Some of them had come. But at Badr, there were only a few of the Sahaba compared to at Uhud. One half of them were less than one half. And even at Badr, only some of the rules are revealed. And so the Sahaba were not aware that technically speaking, every single person is going to get the same share of the ghanima. The whole ghanima is basically collected, and then everybody gets a share of the ghanima. So, and this is the ghanima that you don't get from the, if a warrior kills another warrior in Islamic fiqh, then he will get the possessions of that warrior immediately, right? But if the battle, if the enemy flees and the thing is left behind, that which is left behind, no one person will take. It doesn't matter if you snatch it. This is a major sin to snatch it and kite it. This is ghalul. This is basically stealing from the war booty. That type of ghanima is left. Or you collect it and you give it in one pile. And then that pile is distributed equally, not quite equally. Those who have a horse or animal and they own it will get more. But the point is that's not relevant to how much you collected with your hands. So the sad part really is that those who were eager for this war booty, subhanAllah, they didn't get their share because they thought this would be our share, right? And they caused the disaster that they caused. So being greedy for elements of this dunya, they neither got this dunya, because that share was not theirs. Even if you collected as much as you could, that's not your property. That's not yours to keep. It has to go back to the pile and it will be distributed evenly. They neither got this, nor of course did they get the better reward. And that is the victory of the battle. And this is the reality. There's a symbolism here. This is the reality of those who prefer the dunya over anything else. They neither get this nor that. And this is a huge symbolic issue of the battle of Uhud. In any case, so when the archers saw the Muslims collecting the booty and coming back to camp. Now what this means, by the way, this we have to draw from the inferences, the Quraysh are nowhere to be seen. Khalas, they've gone. So what this means is we're not talking about 2-3 minutes, we're talking about at least a good 20 minutes have gone by, 30 minutes have gone by. There's a feeling of complacency now. There's a feeling that khalas, it's over, we've won. And the archers are waiting, 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 and nobody sends them a message. And they're seeing all of the other Muslims collect the ghanima. And this is where shaitan got to them, right? That they're waiting and waiting and waiting and no messenger comes. Because from the Prophet's perspective, the battle's not over yet. That's the whole point. He understood it's too early to call it a victory. We need to wait. We need to be patient. So from his perspective, they need to stay there. And he has told them they need to remain until the command comes. So from the perspective of the archers, they feel now neglected. That the other Muslims, and they're at the top of this massive hill, they can see all the way to the end. And they see all of these tents and all of these weapons and all of these animals. And they see all of this food, whatever else they had. And they are collecting all of this ghanima. And so they began disputing amongst themselves, as you know. And this is what Allah refers to. That وَتَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ. This is one of the tanaza' that happened. A number of differences happened between the Muslims. A number of debates happened between the Muslims, and this is one of them, that the archers began debating amongst themselves. And we only have one or two phrases recorded, but again we can use our imagination and be a bit more realistic, that it wasn't just one conversation, that the archers are now having a constant back and forth. Come on, it's our turn, let's go. Another group says, no, we can't go now. And of course, Abdullah ibn Jubayr says that, have you forgotten what the Prophet ﷺ told you? That, kunu makkanakum, stay where you are until my command comes to you. By Allah, I will not move my place until the command comes to me. I will not move my place until the command comes to me. And again, we can imagine, the books don't mention, but we can imagine this type of bickering must have gone on for quite a while. Because nobody just changes their mind in a millisecond. Right? You go back and forth, you see how many people follow your position, it's human nature. If you're all alone, khalas, you stick with the jama'ah. But if you get more and more people, you feel confident. And so we can imagine that from the 50, perhaps in the beginning only one or two are basically raising the banner to go and participate. Slowly but surely, perhaps over 40 minutes, perhaps over an hour, we don't know how long. But it cannot be immediate. It's not something that happened in a millisecond. After a period of time, eventually 40 of the people are now saying, come on, let's go. Enough is enough. Now 40 is basically, 80%, right? 40 out of 50 is 80%. That's a huge majority. And therefore, they descended on their horses and their some of them didn't. They descended down and they left only 10 people on the mountain. And of course, this is the fursa. This is the opportunity that Khalid ibn al-Walid saw. So what does this mean? This means that Khalid ibn al-Walid, even as he is fleeing, he is not running for dear life. He is fleeing, but cautiously. And he's looking behind to see what he can do. And this shows us the military genius that he had, that the only the only person who ever inflicted a genuine loss on the Muslims was Khalid ibn al-Walid. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose him to basically convert and join the ranks of Muslims. Otherwise, in the Meccan and the Medina period, the only person who inflicted a military loss and a military defeat upon the Muslims is Khalid ibn al-Walid. And this shows us he really is a military genius. And we know Khalid has a stellar career ahead of him. We know that he is the one who carved out basically most of the Muslim empire, that one conquest after another. This was Khalid ibn al-Walid. And he is showing, even as a young man, he's in his early 20s now, he's showing, and this is his first real battle, the Battle of Uhud. He wasn't participating in Battle of Badr, he was not there. This is his first real battle, and we see now the military genius. Some people, they have it. Allah blesses certain people with talents. Khalid had that talent. And so, you can imagine, he's looking back, he's seeing, what can I do, what can I do? And as soon as he sees the 40 people go down, immediately his brain goes into action. He knows exactly what needs to be done. And this means as well that he would have realized that the area we showed you in the map last Wednesday, that area is now empty. And as I said now, here is where we get two analyses, the first of which we find in many books, and that is that Khalid ibn al-Walid went behind the mountain of Uhud. But as I said, this honestly does not make any academic sense. It is an impossible position to hold if you actually see the mountain of Uhud, and then to go all the way around it by car will take you 45 minutes by car. So can you imagine by horse, and many of them didn't have horses, they're walking. It's really impossible to imagine 6-7 hours are going to go by. That's a bit too much, because by then even the Muslims would have packed up and gone if nothing happens for that long, right? So realistically then, it wasn't that Khalid went from all the way behind, we showed you the maps last Wednesday, rather when he saw from the distance what is happening, he launched a frontal assault. But obviously he didn't charge, he basically carved his way in from the right hand side. Basically we can imagine like a U-turn, right, going a little bit out so nobody sees him. And this is what Sheikh Safi Rahman also, he demonstrated for us, that the most realistic course of events was that there is a valley, as I showed you in the map last Wednesday, that it kind of goes underneath the land, obviously. So if you enter into this not a valley, we tried less time to talk about this waterway, empty waterway, right, the channel that fills up in the time of rain. If you're in this, then people cannot see you at ground level, because you're obviously underneath, right? So this is Sheikh Safi Rahman's interpretation, which makes more sense. That this is how Khalid managed to get together a group, and then he entered this ditch, and he walked with his people. And how many did he have? We have no idea. But again, we estimate, we think, we try to analyze the situation, and a rough estimate that makes sense is probably around 100. Or maximum 150. It couldn't really be more than that, or else the damage would have been much more, right? It couldn't have been less than that, or else he wouldn't have been able to inflict that much damage. So we have a good quantity of people that have come in. Now, again, I hope you remember the map. So the problem here is that when Khalid ibn Walid is coming back from behind the mountain, in effect, he is having, or if you like, cutting the Muslim army into half, right? Because he's basically walking in, and on his right side will be the camp of the Prophet ﷺ, and on his left side will be the Muslims who are collecting ghanima, right? So in reality, what he's done is he's effectively cut off the strength of the Muslims that they had utilized when they were fighting in one jabha, in one vicinity, right? I hope you remember the map, because I didn't ask for it this time around. But again, just think of it, when you think of the mountain, you come back in, where we said that the Prophet was camped right in the corner, and three areas are protecting him, right? Now, this protection turns against them, because they're blocked off. And that's why the Prophet understood the danger of an attack from this side. This protection, which was their protection, turns against the Muslims. Because now Khalid ibn Walid is coming with his sudden entourage, his sudden group, and they have nowhere to flee, because they're effectively cut off. Similarly, the Muslims in front are dispersed. They're not in one group. They're cut off from their main supplies. We also can infer that many of them had abandoned their armor. Many of them didn't even have their weapons because again, they're now collecting ghanima. They were piling up things, and when you're piling up ghanima, you're not going to have a sword in one hand. Again, these are not mentioned, but we extrapolate. We use our common sense that they would have taken their armor off. They would have put their weapons back in their tents. Now they're going back and they're collecting ghanima. An hour has gone by, hour and a half has gone by, and they're feeling very complacent. Khalas, is all over. But an hour and a half is not enough time. An hour and a half is just enough time for Khalid to see what's happening and come back around. And he attacks them, as we said, from behind Jabal al-Ruma. And the first person to see Khalid ibn al-Walid, in fact, it was none other than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The first person to monitor what is going on is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And this shows us that, in fact, and again, we're surmising this, that in fact he felt uneasy at this situation, that he is being extra cautious, whereas the Sahaba are being complacent. And it was in his nature to obviously take every precaution. And while the Sahaba have basically thought, khalas, it's over now, the Prophet ﷺ is monitoring as carefully as possible, and he was the first person to see the flank coming in, a surprise attack coming in. And it is human instinct that when you see an enemy coming, you turn around and flee. It's also very dangerous for the Prophet ﷺ to give his own location away, because he knows he is the center of target. He is the one that they're targeting. And therefore, we can imagine if any one of us had been in a similar situation, we would have immediately fled surreptitiously and quietly, not drawn attention to ourselves. But this is not any one of us, this is our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And therefore he did what we would only expect him to do, which is the bravest thing imaginable, and that is he stood up and at the top of his lungs he started shouting for the Muslims that, O Muslims, behind you. Who is he speaking to now? He's speaking to those who are in the battlefield, and he's yelling as loud as he can that, be careful, they're attacking from behind you, right? That, take your heather, take your precautions, they're coming from behind. And so by yelling out, he's effectively given his own coordinates away. Because everybody knows, you know, the voice of the Prophet. I mean, who else is going to be commanding them, all Muslims? Everybody recognizes his voice. So by shouting at the top of his lungs, he's done something that is really extremely brave, and that is to give away his own coordinates. But had he not given this warning, probably the massacre would have been double or triple than it was. Right? That at least by giving this warning, some people could take precautions and take up their arms and put on their armor. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran. And again, we're going to talk about all of these verses in detail in a future, maybe next Wednesday or the Wednesday after that. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذْ تُصْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْوُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ. Right? Recall, remember, when you were basically fleeing onto the mountains, right? إِذْ تُصْعِدُونَ وَلَا تَلْوُونَ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ. And you were not caring about anybody. You weren't looking about anybody. وَالرَّسُولُ يَدْعُوكُمْ فِي أُخْرَاكُمْ. And your Prophet ﷺ was calling you from your back, from your behind. Right at the back, he was calling you to come. Right? And so Allah Azza wa Jal describes vividly the reality of the situation, that when some of the Sahaba saw the surprise attack, they started fleeing, which is the human instinct to do, which is what I said, that any other leader would have done that. And so Allah describes the Sahaba as running away, and the Prophet ﷺ calling to the Sahaba to take precautions to come back to fight. And as can be expected, such a surprise attack, it led to total chaos in the ranks of the Muslims. The Muslims were taken totally by surprise, and some of them had not even regrouped. Some of them were basically in small pockets, 4, 5, 10, maybe even one or two. And as the Quran mentions, many of them, because they were unarmed, because they didn't have even groups, they simply turned their backs and fled. Just like the ladies of Quraysh had fled an hour or 2 hours ago, now, probably on the same mountaintops, now the Muslims are fleeing. And again, there's symbolism here, that this is what happens when you disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger. Now, other Muslims who were closer to the rank of Khalid ibn Walid, so they're basically closer to the camp of the base of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, it appears that Shaytan did a trick or a tactic on them. And Shaytan wanted to cause chaos between the Muslims who are now going to face one another. So you have the Muslim base, the camp, and then you have the Muslims in the battlefield. Khalid and Walid is in the middle. So what's going to happen? The two Muslims or armies or groups are going to be facing one another. And in the chaos, some Muslims were killed at the swords of other Muslims. And we have narrations that Shaytan was the one who instigated this confusion. That he would trick some of the groups by basically saying that, careful, the enemy is right there. And the enemy right there was none other than another Muslim group coming in. And in the chaos and the confusion, perhaps we can also imagine, and again we are assuming, that many of them were wearing helmets, let's say, right? And so they couldn't recognize who the person was. And unfortunately, we had some tragic deaths here. And the most tragic of these deaths was, who can tell me? Walid Hudhayfa, the father of Hudhayfa, and his name is, anybody who knows this deserves a prize. His name, this is a very obscure fact, not many people know. Of course, they call him Yaman, but that's not his name, Hudhayfa bin Yaman. La, you're getting confused with that's Hamzala Ghazil al-Malaika. His father is the Rahib. His Hudhayfa, his father was Husayl ibn Jabir. Husayl ibn Jabir. Husayl. And he was not from the Ansar, he was from the tribe of, he was from the tribe of Abbasi. And in the days of Jahiliyyah, he had committed a murder, and his own people basically disowned him. He had to flee from his own people, and he formed an alliance with one of the tribes of Medina, who were to become the Ansar. So he formed an alliance with them, he became their Mawla, or their Halif is a better word. And so when he formed an alliance with them, his people then started calling him Yamani. You are the one who's formed the alliance with the people of Yaman. They called the people of Medina Yamani, right? And so they called him Yaman. And so his nickname became Yaman. Then he married one of the ladies of Medina. We don't call them Ansar at this time because there's no Islam. And eventually when the Prophet ﷺ began preaching in Mecca, he was of the earliest converts, Yaman. He's of the earliest converts. And he accepts Islam. And then Hudhayfa embraces Islam before the Prophet ﷺ emigrates. So Hudhayfa becomes a Muslim before the Prophet ﷺ emigrates. And of course Hudhayfa is famous because he is Sahibus Sir. He is the keeper of secrets. The Prophet ﷺ chose him for a very noble task, and that is to tell him all of the names of the hypocrites that Allah had told him. Right? So Hudhayfa was known as Sahibus Sir, the keeper of secrets, the one whom the Prophet ﷺ told all of the names of the Munafiqun to. And you know the story of Umar, that he came and he begged Hudhayfa to tell him, am I a munafiq or not? And Hudhayfa said, Allah, the Prophet did not mention you, but I'm not going to talk to anybody else after you. And it is said that perhaps he did this because he knew that the Prophet had made Umar of the 10 Ashara Mubashara. So there's no secret he's divulging if he tells Umar, you are going to Jannah, because he's already been told he's going to Jannah, right? Because otherwise, how can he tell a secret? So he didn't tell Umar a secret. He told Umar what Umar should have known already, which is you are one of the Ashara Mubashara. In any case, so his father was Husayl ibn Jabir, as we said. And what had happened in the battle of Badr, by the way, so when the Prophet ﷺ emigrated to Medina, it is said that Husayl asked him, O Messenger of Allah, am I an Ansari or a Muhajir? Because he's neither from Mecca nor from Medina. He's actually not from either of these two cities. So what am I? And so the Prophet ﷺ said, you are both an Ansari and a Muhajir, because he had emigrated from another land to Medina, and he's also living in Medina, right? So the Prophet ﷺ gave him an honor, you are an Ansari and a Muhajir. So he get the honor of being both of them. This is Walidu Hudhayfa, this is Yaman we're talking about. And in the Battle of Badr, famous story took place as well. I mentioned this in the Battle of Badr, that Hudhayfa and his father Yaman, now it's unclear where were they. Were they going away from Mecca, or they exiting Medina? It's unclear, the reports don't mention. But the Quraysh caught them on their way to the Battle of Badr. The Quraysh caught them on their way to the Battle of Badr. And the Quraysh knew that Yaman is not Ansari, and he's not from Medina, and he's not, obviously, so they didn't have that animosity towards him. But they said, where are you going? Are you going to fight with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And so the both of them said, no, we're not. No, they have a sword to their throats. What do you expect them to say? They're allowed to. No, we're not. So they said, no, you have to promise by Allah that you are not going to fight against us. You're not going to fight against us. And so there's a sword there, I mean, there's no alternative. So they promise that they are not going to fight. So the Quraysh left them. They make their way to the Prophet ﷺ and they tell them the story. And the Prophet ﷺ says, go fulfill your promise, go back to Medina. That's a very important story here, right? Go fulfill your promise, you made a promise. You cannot fight with us, go back to Medina. And so, Hudhayfa and Yaman, they got the reward of Badr without actually being at Badr. So again, another blessing, right? Their niyyah was there, they got to Badr, but they weren't allowed to fight because of the promise. And this also shows us, by the way, when you have a specific promise, even with an enemy, and you have made a specific promise to them, then in this case, it is not allowed to break your promise in this manner, because we are not allowed to break our promises. And this is very relevant to modern political issues, but that's a tangent I've been into before. So where was I? Hudhayfa and his father. What else do we need to know about Hudhayfa before we move on? So Hudhayfa, by this age, he's now very elderly, he's losing his eyesight. He's one of the two people, there's only two people, that at the Battle of Uhud, they were so old, the Prophet ﷺ said, go and stay in the city, don't fight with us. So Hudhayfa is one of those, we can imagine him feeble and old. He is so old that they are exempt from fighting. So Hudhayfa and this other man from the Ansar, they were sitting basically with the women and children, and obviously what happens, their manhood gets the better of them, their iman gets the better of them, and they start rebuking each other and themselves. Like, how can we do this? What is the point? And Hudhayfa says, how long do we have left to live? A day, an hour? I mean, we're so old now. How long do we have left to live? And his companion says, you are right. Let us go, and perhaps Allah will end our lives with the shahada, which is what we want. Right? Yaman. Did I say Hudhayfa? Yes. Sorry. Yaman. Yaman's the elderly person, right? Yaman's the old person. So Yaman, sorry, you're right, I'm saying Hudhayfa. Yaman and another of the Ansar. They're both elderly, and they both decide to make their way to Uhud after they have been basically exempt from coming to Uhud. There's one problem. By the time they come, this is when Khalid is now attacking. So they come at a chaotic time, and they join the battle at a time of chaos. And this was when Shaitan cries out that, O Muslims, behind you. And when they turned around, there was Yaman standing right there. And so a group of them, not recognizing Yaman because he was not in the battle in the morning, he wasn't there. A group of them not recognizing Yaman, they surrounded him and they began using their swords. And Hudhayfa recognizes his father, because obviously a father recognizes his son, the son recognizes his father. As we know, you recognize your children and vice versa simply by the back of their heads or by one limb or something. This is the way that Allah created. You recognize, right? So he recognizes his father from the distance. And he began screaming that, Abi, Abi, this is my father, this is my father, stop from doing this. But they're not going to hear the dint of the battle, the emotions, the fear, everything is just the battle. And they struck him and they basically killed him. It was a sad and tragic story. And at the end of the battle, when it was all over, they came and asked forgiveness. And Hudhayfa said, يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحِيمِينَ. Surah Yusuf, same thing. يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّحِيمِينَ. And the Prophet ﷺ paid him the blood money for his father from the Baytul Mal. That this is our fault. The Muslim, even though it's not his fault, the Prophet, but it's responsibility of the Muslim Ummah. So he paid him the blood money, which is 100 camels, which is a lot of money. And Hudhayfa took this money and he distributed it to the fuqara. All of it. And this obviously made him, the way who he was. And as one of the Sahaba said, that Hudhayfa forever lived in good after that incident. That incident was what boosted his ranks. وَمَا زَالَ فِي خَيْرِ. He always lived in good up until the end of his life. And the Prophet ﷺ then rewarded him by making him صاحب السر, the one who took the secrets of the Prophet ﷺ. Now, as we said, it's a very chaotic situation, and all we can do is to mention specific incidents that happened. And of course, the saddest incident of, or one of the saddest incidents of Uhud, is the death of Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. The death of Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ, and also a very close friend. And someone whom had defended the Prophet ﷺ in Mecca. If you remember his conversion story, do you remember his conversion story? That he actually converted hamiyatan. He converted out of family pride. He didn't convert out of actual iman in the beginning. He converted because Abu Jahl had insulted his nephew. Right? And he got so angry that somebody could insult his family that just on the spur he said, did you insult him? وَأَنَا عَلَى دِينِهِ. And he didn't even realize, as the riwayah go, he didn't even realize what he's saying. But once he blurts it out, he's not going to take it back. Right? And then after that, his iman became stronger and stronger until he becomes Sayyid al-Shuhada. He becomes Sayyid al-Shuhada. And the story is, of course, known to all of us, but there's no harm in repeating it again, because after all, really, these are the stories that yani, increase our iman. They make us understand how the sacrifices that our ummah went through, the sacrifices of our Prophet ﷺ himself. We know that, of course, Hamza was killed by Wahshi. And who was Wahshi? Wahshi was the slave of Jubayd ibn Mut'im. Jubayd ibn Mut'im. Now, Jubayd ibn Mut'im, Mut'im ibn Adi, we talked a lot about. Mut'im ibn Adi, we talked about what a noble person he was, right? But father and son can be different. Jubayd eventually accepts Islam, so we say radiallahu anhu, but at the time he's not a Muslim. So, Jubayr ibn Mut'im, now his father Mut'im, we mentioned, he was the most noble of the whole Quraysh who opposed the Prophet after Abu Talib. So Abu Talib and Mut'im ibn Adi are the two noble non-Muslims. Right? There's only two that are genuinely good non-Muslims in a politically good sense. Not good in a theological sense, good in a political sense. So Mut'im and Abu Talib. And his son is Jubayr. Now Mut'im dies before Badr. Mut'im doesn't see Badr. Mut'im is the one the Prophet says, لو كان مُطْعِمْ حَيًّا. Right? ثُمَّ كَلَّمَنِي فِي هَلَا أَنَّتْنَا لَأَطْلَقْتُهُ لَهُمْ. That's Mut'im. If Mut'im had been alive, one word, and all of these are given to him. Right? That's Mut'im. This is his son. So, in the Battle of Badr, Mut'im's brother, Jubayr's uncle, is killed. Okay? Mut'im's younger brother, Jubayr's uncle, Jubayr ibn Mut'im. Jubayr's uncle is killed. And his name was Tu'aymah. Tu'aymah ibn Adi. So Mut'im ibn Adi, Tu'aymah ibn Adi. He had been killed by Hamza. So Hamza was the one who killed Tu'aymah. So Jubayr, in his hamiyya, in his basically family pride, and that's what they are used to, that family issue, he killed my uncle, khalas, he's gonna die for that. So Jubayr tells his slave Wahshi that, look, if you kill Hamza, then you will get your freedom. And so it's a double, if you like, revenge. First revenge is you kill the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ just like my uncle was killed. And the second, the same person, you kill the person who killed my uncle. You see the point here. There's two motivations here, right? Just like I lost my uncle, the Prophet ﷺ is going to lose his uncle. That's motivation. And then of course there's a direct motivation. He killed my uncle, he's gonna also die. So there's a double motivation for killing Hamza. And Wahshi himself narrates his story. And in fact we have his story preserved in the first person, because it is narrated that two of the Tabi'un, they visited one of the cities of Iraq, where Wahshi had become an old man. And they visited the city and they said, let us go to Wahshi, the one who killed Hamza, and ask him how he killed Hamza. And so the two of them, their names are mentioned in the books, but we have not come across them, so there's no point confusing you. The two of them, they entered it upon Hamza, Wahshi, excuse me. They entered it upon Wahshi, and Wahshi had grown almost blind. And it is said that he looked at the feet of one of them, and immediately said, are you so-and-so, the son of so-and-so? And he said, yes, I am. So he said, I played with your feet when you were a baby in Mecca. I played with you as a baby in Mecca, meaning. I played with you as a baby in Mecca. So subhanAllah, the Arabs had a science, by the way, of feet reading. You know this, or you know this, huh? They had a science of feet reading. They would tell nasab, they would tell genealogy by looking at the feet. They would tell genealogy by looking at the feet. And there are stories in the Seerah about this as well. Usama and Zayd were lying down under one blanket, right? Usama ibn Zayd. Usama and Zayd were lying down under one blanket. And Usama was dark-skinned, And Zayd was light skinned. Why was Usama dark skinned? Because his mother is. His mother is who?
Mubarak.
His mother is an Abyssinian slave, and Zayd is an Arab, and Usama came like his mother. And you know how people are, they started speaking, you know, there was a rumor going on, you know, when Usama was born. And Usama and Zayd were lying under a blanket. This is in Sahih Bukhari. And one of these feet readers came, and they're covered up. So he said, these feet are from these feet. Usama is the son of this person. But he doesn't know who they are. And Aisha says, the Prophet ﷺ was so happy to hear this, that, you know, this type of rumor will be finished now, right? Even though he doesn't need to hear, but the people need to hear this, right? Again, I'm going to my tangents, let's get back here, where are we? So he looks at the feet of this person, he goes, verily I played with your feet, meaning I played with you when you were a baby, right? So what do you want from me? And so he says, we have come to listen to you how you killed Hamza. So he said, I will tell you exactly word for word as I told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So he tells them the entire story, and he says that I was a slave in Mecca, and I had no desire to fight or kill. I have no desire to get involved in the war. However, my master Jubayr promised me my freedom if I killed Hamza, and so I took my best javelin, my best spear, and I went into the battle, and wallahi I had no desire to do anyone harm except for Hamza in order to get my freedom. I have no hatred against him. So he's making an excuse. I didn't want to participate. It's nothing, something that I have. I just wanted to be a free man, right? And we understand that type of emotion, that he simply wanted to be a free man. So he said, I began following Hamza. Wherever he's going, I'm following Hamza to see what he is doing. And I kept on hiding from him to go behind him, until finally he said that when Hamza killed so-and-so, and he mentions one of the Quraysh, so Hamza, by the way, had killed a whole list, even in Uhud, Hamza had killed a long list. So when Hamza killed so-and-so, he chopped him off. As soon as he lowered the sword, Wahshi is saying, I stepped out from behind the bush. So he's literally hiding behind the bush, right? I stepped out from behind the bush, his back was to him. I mean, this is really low. I mean, but he's not caring about chivalry right now. He doesn't care about fighting like a man. He just wants his freedom. So Hamza's back was towards him, and he said, I threw my javelin with the most force that I could. So this is point blank range. You're killing from the back. There is simply no way. So he says, it came, and now this is, can you imagine? Wallahi, can you imagine the force that he must have thrown the javelin with? He said, it came out from behind, and it came into the front, and the javelin was literally half in the body now, right? That is force. And Hamza, Wahshi says, Hamza turned around to try to fight me. SubhanAllah, what a man. What a man. The javelin is sticking out, right? Turned around to try to fight me. But before he could raise his sword, yani, you're not going to live this thing. He simply collapsed right there and died before he could, do anything. It is also said, by the way, that Wahshi aimed to an area that is between his armor, like in the armor chinks. What are you going to call it? Like, you know, the place that is not fully covered. You know, the armors in those days, they were coats, they were rings. Right, so Wahshi is an expert javelin thrower, so he's aiming to see when the armor basically slides here or there, or there's a little bit of a hole, and this is not too far-fetched either for someone as skilled as Wahshi, that he actually is aiming for an area that Hamza would not even have had any armor, and this would make sense, the force that it is now coming out one. And subhanAllah, we can say, how else would Hamza have been killed? Nobody could kill him in one-on-one combat. Nobody could have killed him like a man. How else would he be killed except in this manner, which is not a noble manner? It's not the manner that you do one-on-one battle with. But again, Wahshi doesn't care, and he makes an excuse for himself. I didn't care about Hamza at all. I simply wanted my freedom. And also, it is amazing as well that Jubayr, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to Islam eventually as well. That Jubayr ibn Mut'im, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him with Islam, and he becomes a Sahabi, and his sins are forgiven. And by the way, Jubayr, he was one of the prisoners at Badr. And Jubayr says that the first time a little bit of Iman entered my heart was when I heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recite Surah At-Tur. So remember, where were the prisoners housed? In the masjid. So all of the prisoners are in the masjid. So he's tied up to the pillar of the masjid, Jubair. And you can imagine every day the Prophet and the Sahaba are coming to pray salah. So he says, the first time Iman entered my heart was when the Prophet recited Surah At-Tur in Salat al-Maghrib. And he got to the verse, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ. Now again, Surah At-Tur, just like Surah Al-Najm, it's a powerful surah. It builds up to a crescendo, like an amazing ending. There's a series of like 15 rhetorical questions at the end, just like Surah Al-Najm, by the way, as well. It's very powerful. And one of the last, right at the end of it, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ, which basically Allah is saying, where did you come from? Did you come out of nowhere or did you create yourselves? Right? So, Jubayr ibn Mut'im said that when I heard the Prophet on doing that tilawa, kada qalbi an yutir, my heart was about to break out of my chest and just fly out. Right? Can you imagine the tilawa of the Prophet, how would it have impacted? Right? So Jubayr ibn Mut'im said, this was the first time that Iman entered my heart, but Allah had willed, he's not going to accept Islam now. Not at Uhud, because he has things to do for the sake of history, for the sake of wisdom, Allah knows. So he's not a Muslim yet, but eventually he will accept Islam. Wahshi, by the way, there's stuff that is generally not mentioned too often in popular lectures, but I feel that there's always wisdom in mentioning what Allah Azza wa Jalla has allowed our tradition to preserve. Wahshi, there's also some dark side as well. And inshallah, Allah will forgive him and all of us. He is, after all, a sahabi, and he repented from that sin. Wahshi, when the Prophet ﷺ conquered Mecca, so Wahshi fled to Ta'if. Because he knows, I mean, everybody knows how devastated the Prophet ﷺ was. This is his uncle, it's his beloved. Wahshi knows, he's not going to spare me. So Wahshi, before the Prophet ﷺ comes, he flees to Ta'if. Ta'if, of course, remains non-Muslim for another year, and he's in there. Then, the next year, Ta'if also caves in, as we're going to come to when we come to. And so Ta'if sends a delegation. Wahshi says, I had no idea what to do. I felt the whole world is going to collapse on me. And I decided to go into exile in Syria. Until finally somebody said to me, Wayhaka ya Wahshi, woe to you, O Wahshi. Don't you know that if you accept this man's religion, he never kills anybody who accepts his own religion? So he said, I decided to accept Islam. So obviously, he's accepting it for a reason that is understandable. But it's not the reason that, let's say, Abu Bakr Umar accepted Islam, right? So he said, I decided to accept Islam. And so I hid myself, the covering that the Bedouins do, you know, the talatama, the covering of the face, right? So I hid myself in my turban, and I made my way to Mecca, and I came into the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I unfolded the turban, because he knows he's going to be killed on sight. And before anybody could say anything, he says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu annaka rasulullah. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Awahshiyun ant, you are Wahshi? Because Allah didn't recognize who he recognizes who he is, and so he says, yes, I am Wahshi. So he says, come and tell me how you killed Hamza. SubhanAllah. Come and tell me how you killed Hamza. And so Wahshi told him how he killed Hamza. And Wahshi says the Prophet ﷺ cried until his beard became wet. So he is crying now when he hears this detailed story. Here is the man who did this. And then he said to Wahshi, hide yourself from me, let me not see your face. Hide yourself from me, let me not see your face. Because obviously you can imagine, the memories that you're going to get, the pain you're going to get, that you killed my, in this manner, you killed my uncle. This is even in a gentle way. He didn't say get lost or go, he simply said, hide yourself from me so I don't see you. So Wahshi would always, what a punishment, we seek Allah's refuge, but what a difficult punishment in this world, right? That anytime he sees the Prophet, he has to go behind the pillar, he has to hide behind somebody, he is not allowed to come in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there is another thing that I said that not many people like to mention, but it is reported in all of our classical books, and there is wisdom in this. And as I said, Allah will forgive him and inshallah all of us as well. We are all sinful in our own ways. Wahshi was known for being involved in drinking till the end of his days. And Umar had him punished multiple times. So much so that Umar said that, Wallahi, I knew that Allah would not leave Qatilu Hamza untouched. Wallahi, I knew that Allah would not leave the one who killed Hamza without some issue. Right? Some issue, some punishment, something like this. I knew Allah was not going to leave him like this, that he's done something so big, it's not going to be left untouched. And so he was punished multiple times. Now, of course, drinking, according to Islamic fiqh, you are basically lashed, 40 times. And there's no, every time you drink, you're just lashed. So you keep on lashed. So Wahji was lashed a number of times until Umar got irritated at him and said, Wallahi, I knew Allah was not going to leave Qatilu, Hamza. However, at the end of his life, he did repent, and it is said that when, he said himself, and so when he's describing to these two young men in front of him, he said when he heard about Musaylama al-Kadhab, he said, he made a dua to Allah that, O Allah, allow me to take the life of Musaylama in substitution for what I did to Hamza. Like, this is my kafara. Right, so he said, SubhanAllah, I took the same spear that I killed Hamza with. And I went with Khalid ibn Walid. Now he is an old man now, right? This is many years later now that he's talking about this. Or maybe not old, but he's not the young person that he was. A decade or more has gone in the battle of Musaylama, right? So I went now with Khalid ibn Walid and I targeted Musaylama like I targeted Hamza. Right, and he says that when I was in front of him, I threw my javelin, and at the same time, one of the Ansar attacked him from the other side with his sword. So Allah knows which of the two actually killed. So both of them basically simultaneously came upon Musaylama al-Kadhab. So he says Allah knows which of the two of us killed him, but he considered this to be his kafara. That because of this, I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives. And of course, technically, he did this when he was a non-Muslim. So it's not as if that sin will be on his, mawazin on the Day of Judgment. But nonetheless, can you imagine the guilt he would have felt, right? And this is what he wanted to do, in return for what he had done. And as I said, may Allah forgive. And inshallah, Allah will forgive him. He is a sahabi. And by the way, this leads us to a theological issue. Some people get confused when they hear a sahabi did this or that. And they do not realize that the sahaba are human. And they are the best generation, no doubt. But that doesn't make them superhuman. So the sahaba also have some of the problems that everybody else does. After all, were there not people who committed zina in the lifetime of the Prophet ﷺ and they were punished? Correct? Right? Were there not people who physically fought in the masjid? We know they argued in the masjid. Things are happening over money, over this or that. They are, after all, humans, but as a generation, they are the best. And we differentiate between pointing out one of these types of sins or issues in order to basically show their humanity versus pointing them out in order to denigrate them, right? Allah says in the Quran, radiyallahu anhum wa radu an, as a generation. And so every sahabi, we say radiyallahu anhum wa radu an. And we say that no matter what sin the sahaba would do, there is one sin that Allah has protected them from, and that is the sin of lying about Allah and His Messenger. And that is very true, by the way. So the sin of basically being unfaithful to Allah and His Messenger, they cannot do that. But other issues, which are human issues, zina, khamr, this is getting angry, fighting, this is human issue, right? And the sahaba, some of them, they fell into these issues. And the fact that they fell into it does not diminish from radiyallahu anhum wa radu an, right? As a category, they are radiyallahu anhum wa radu an, but this doesn't mean that they are superhuman, and so this issue of wahshi should be put into this context. Now we also know, by the way, that when wahshi was had killed Hamza, we all know what Hind did on the battlefield. So by the way, what this shows, and a lot of people don't put this together, Hamza was killed in the victory half of Uhud, not in the losing half. Right? Hamza was killed in the first 20-30 minutes, basically, right? Or hour. I'm not giving an exact time frame, but before Khalid comes in, Hamza was killed in the initial assault that Wahshi is monitoring from the very beginning. So this is an important point. Khalid and Walid is coming and Hamza has already been mutilated, right? Because before Hind runs away, what does Hind do? We all know what she does. And she also accepted Islam, so Allah has forgiven her as well. And this is Allah's wisdom. He chooses whom He wants. That as a sign of pure hatred, as a sign of inflicting pain upon the Prophet ﷺ, because there is no other reason to do this, right? As a sign of inflicting pain upon the Prophet ﷺ, she basically, with her own dagger, she slits open the stomach of Hamza, and takes out his liver, and bites it, and spits it out, right? And, it's a bit disgusting, she cuts off his fingers, and according to some reports, his toes, and she built a necklace out of them. And again, all of this is done in order to nothing except to inflict pain upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's no other reason to do this, right? And this is the level of hatred, the level of, you know, at that time they had. And it is amazing that Allah decided to guide her. This we say Allah knows best. We say we trust in Allah's judgment, right? Somebody that had so much hiqd and so much anger, still for a wisdom known to him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides that after the conquest of Mecca, she will basically embrace Islam along with Abu Sufyan. Of course, Hind is the wife of Abu Sufyan, right? And so she is like the queen. She is the prime lady of Quraysh. Right, so she is making that statement that this is who we are and this is what we're going to do to you. And when our Prophet ﷺ saw the body of Hamza, he cried. And this, of course, after all of the battle is over, after he cried and he said, were it not for the fact that Safiya would grieve. Now, Safiya and Hamza are full brothers and sisters, not half, full, the same parents. Safiya and Hamza are full brother and sister. And so they have an even closer bond. Were it not for the fact that Safiya's heart would grieve, and the people would then take this as sunnah, if I were to do this, I would have left his body untouched. I would have left his body untouched until it dispersed in the beasts of the bellies of the beasts and the birds. I.e., I want his body to be plucked even more, so that Allah honors him even more. And so that Allah will then collect his body from all of these different places as an honor for Hamza, right? So what the Prophet is saying is that were it not for Safiya's grief and for the fact that what I'm doing would then become sunnah, and this is another issue that ijtihad that he made right then and there, and that if I had done this, it would have become sunnah, but I don't want to open that door, I would have left his body untouched. And I would have let it decompose and let the animals come to literally, she thinks she's cut off the fingers, let him be dispersed in a million places. Then let Allah gather him from all of those million as a karama, as a blessing, as a means of honoring Hamza. This is what I would have done, but I didn't want to do that because of these two reasons. And then he said that, and if Allah ever gives me victory over the Quraysh, I shall mutilate 30 of their bodies because of this one. So he said this. He said, I shall mutilate 30 for one. 30 juthath I will mutilate for this one. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed later on, after Uhud, that وَإِنْ عَاقَبْتُمْ فَعَاقِبُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا عُوقِبْتُمْ بِهِ وَلَئِنْ صَبَرْتُمْ لَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لِلصَّابِرِينَ. If you're going to take revenge exactly equivalent as what happened to you. But if you are patient and forgive, it is better. If you are turn the other cheek, it is better for you, for those who forgive, for those who are patient. And so when this ayah came down, the Prophet ﷺ, he gave a permanent commandment that no dead body should ever be mutilated. So this shows us that the Prophet ﷺ made ijtihad and Allah corrects him. This also shows us that mutilation has been forbidden uncategorically. It has been forbidden. So initially, the Prophet ﷺ said, I will take revenge. But he never actually did it, right? It's just a threat that if I get victory, I shall mutilate 30 bodies. Then Allah revealed, turn the other cheek, forgive, it is better. So then the Prophet ﷺ took this from Allah and he said, Khalas, from now on, it is not allowed to mutilate any dead body, Muslim or Kafir, it doesn't matter. We don't mutilate bodies. This is not of our tradition. And so the Prophet and the Sahaba never mutilated anybody. Even if it's not a Muslim, even as the Badr shows, you give them some type of burial, but you do not mutilate dead bodies. And this is the story of Hamza. Other stories as well that we know is the story of Mus'ab ibn Umair. And Mus'ab ibn Umair, when was he killed? Was he killed in the offensive or when Khalid ibn Walid came? Most likely, Mus'ab was killed by the forces of Khalid. And again, this is one of those issues that we're trying to piece together when things happened. Most likely, Mus'ab was killed by the forces of Khalid. And he was targeted because, unlike those who were taking booty, he was still carrying the flag. So he was one of the first targets for the contingent of Khalid ibn Walid. Now again, we're assuming it's Khalid. The books don't mention who did it. It just says this happened. But the point being, if the Muslims were so victorious in the beginning, it's difficult to imagine Mus'ab being killed so brutally. So my ijtihad and Allah knows best, Mus'ab is killed in the second half. And that is Khalid. And this makes complete sense now, because his story is also very gruesome. And that is that, now of course, Mus'ab is that young man we know that his father was one of the richest traders of Mecca, and he was known for being the most spoiled prince of Mecca, that he would wear a new qamis every day or a new garment every few days, that he would buy the most expensive perfumes. His mother was well known to be spoiling him completely. His mother would give the best of garments and things to him, and he was tortured by his own mother and father. As you know, he was literally locked up by his own mother and father. His own mother deprived him of food and water when he converted to Islam. The same woman who gave him perfumes and the most expensive garments, now that he gave up idolatry and worshipped Allah, she locked him up and deprived him of food. He had to break his chains and run away to Medina. He was the first muhajir to Medina, remember, right? Because he had no house in Mecca. He had no place to live. So the Prophet ﷺ sent him to Medina 2 years before the Hijrah. The first muhajir to Medina was Mus'ab. And his role was dual. Number one, to run away from Mecca. Number two, to preach to Medina. If you remember the story, we talked about it, right? And because he was intelligent, because he was of a noble class, he knew how to interact with people, he won the hearts and mind of the Ansar. And at his hands, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided every single tribe had Muslims because of him. This is what the books of Seerah say. Every tribe, there were members that converted at his hand, right? So this is Mus'ab ibn Umair. And he was known for being gentle and loving. And because he was young and now he was penniless, he never got married as well, because he does not have any money at all. And in the battle of Uhud, as we know, he died a tragic death. Of course, it is an honorable death as well. And that is that he was holding the flag, and one of the mushriks came, and again we are assuming this is Khalid's force, so he doesn't have Muslims around him to defend him, so his right hand is cut off, and he then holds the flag with his left hand, and now he is completely defenseless, the left hand is cut off, and to remain that izzah, whatever he can, he takes the two stumps and then holds the flag with those stumps, and of course he is waiting for shahada, there's nothing left for him to live, there's no defense basically, and he is killed, multiple stabs and wounds simultaneously, he is killed. And this is why, as I said, it makes complete sense that this is happening in the counter-offensive. Right, this is happening when Khalid is now coming in. Most likely, and this is my reconstruction, the first person they're targeting is the flag bearer, because that's the whole point. They need to show the symbolism. We're back now. Khalas. So the first person they target is a flag bearer. Mus'ab falls a tragic death. And Sahih Bukhari reports the long hadith of Khabbab ibn al-Arat. Khabbab ibn al-Arat was also one of those who was tortured in Mecca, also an early convert like Mus'ab, and he lived a long life, and Allah blessed him to be a governor, and he lived in a house and with servants. Now he dies, now a very different death than what he was in Mecca, right? So Allah gave him a long life. When he was about to die, Khabbab gave a moving speech that caused his people and his family to cry, that we all emigrated with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seeking the rewards of Allah. And so our reward is with Allah. But some of us left this dunya without taking any of that reward in this world. Their full reward is in the hereafter. Of them is Mus'ab ibn Umair. Of them is Mus'ab ibn Umair. He was killed on the day of Uhud. And all that he had was the one garment that he was wearing. One, not even two. the one garment that he's wearing. So if we try to cover up his body, if we covered his bottom half, the top half was naked. And if we covered his top half, then the bottom half is naked. And so the Prophet ﷺ told us to cover up the top half, and then basically maybe his thighs to downwards are left empty. We don't know exactly where, but again, when you have one garment like the ihram, let's say, so it's going to cover maybe to the thighs or something, or maybe to the knees. So we then covered the top half, and then we covered the bottom half with basically hay or idhkhir, not hay, but yani grass or dried up leaves or something. We covered up desert grass. We put it on his feet. And as for the rest of us, he is saying, we moved on in life and Allah blessed us, and now we don't know what Allah is going to do with us. Meaning, I am dying with such luxury, and my friend Mus'ab died in such poverty, I don't know what my fate is going to be. As for Mus'ab, Allah gave him everything in the next. He didn't get one thing in this dunya. And this is of course the tragic Mus'ab ibn Umayr that no doubt he is of those shuhada in Uhud that Allah Azza wa Jal tested him in Mecca, and Allah blessed him in Medina in the way that he did to be that type of shaheed. The story of Hamza as well is known to you. We already mentioned it and it is well known. Hamza is of course the son of al-Rahib, now called al-Fasiq, right? They changed his name from Rahib to Fasiq. Hamza is the one whom when it is said that Hamza was just about to kill Abu Sufyan. That Hamza was just striking distance of Abu Sufyan when a spear came out of nowhere and basically killed him on the spot right then and there. And later on after the battle, the Prophet ﷺ, as you know, it's a well-known story, that he said, I saw the angels washing the body of Hamza, and the body of the shaheed is not washed. So I saw the angels washing the body of Hamza as they took him up. So go ask his wife, because there's only one reason that they're washing. That means he must have been junub. But why is he junub? What's happening? And then we know the story. Of course, all of you know that he was newly married and the wife did not want him to leave, and she's begging and pleading. And so basically on the morning of the battle, she tempts him right then and there. She hugs and begs him. And so he's a young man. He's newly married. So he basically is intimate with her. And then he doesn't even have the time to do ghusl. And so right then and there, he throws on his armor. And khalas, he goes on to the battle without even doing ghusl. So he dies in that state. So he gets a much better bath, mashallah. He gets the bath from up there, and the angels give him the ghusl on the way up to Jannah. And we already mentioned the story of the death of Yaman, the father of Hudhayfa. We already mentioned the story of the death of Yaman. SubhanAllah, I'm trying to finish up. Let's just go a little bit more, because I want to start with the Prophet ﷺ next Wednesday. So there's two more stories, inshallah, today, and then we're done. The other story we have is the story of Quzman. Very interesting story, Quzman. Quzman was of the hypocrites, and he had gone back with Abdullah ibn Ubay. He had not wanted to fight, so he returns back. He's not of the elite of the Sahaba, Quzman, but he's also a warrior. So when he goes back, and he goes back home, the Muslim ladies began rebuking him, making fun of him. They said, what type of man are you? You leave the men in the battlefield and you come back home to us? Have you no shame? And so he felt such a embarrassment that the ladies are mocking me if I come home. So then he decided to return back. But what's his niyyah now? His niyyah was not for the sake of Allah. And so his niyyah is basically to prove my manhood. So he returns back to the battle, completely armed, and Quzman was a warrior. And he fights a very tough and a very brave fighting. So much so that one of the Sahaba comes back to the Prophet, so we understand this is happening the offensive then, the first half. Comes back to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, Quzman is fighting an amazing battle. It's like praising him. Wherever he goes, he's wreaking havoc. The Prophet said, Huwa finnar. Huwa finnar. He's going to be in the fire of hell. The Sahabi says, I got a shock like I had never gotten before. Like this man who's fighting this battle, if he's going to hell, what's wrong? Something must be wrong here, right? So he said, I decided to follow him. I decided to follow him. Like there must be a reason. And so tatabba'tuha, I began following Quzman, and eventually Quzman was hit by an arrow and he began wailing out of pain. until not being able to bear the pain of one arrow, which I'm sure is very painful, may Allah protect us all, but the Sahaba, we just saw Mus'ab and others, what they have done, right? We're not comparing his to us, we are much weaker than all others, but we're comparing him to the people of his generation, right? We just seen all of these other Sahaba, what they're doing. So one arrow comes and hits him somewhere in the limb or something like this, he cannot bear the pain. So what does he do? He takes out his sword and he turns it upside down and he puts the handle on the ground, he puts the sharp side on his stomach, and then he jumps on his own sword because he doesn't want to bear the pain. So he commits suicide because of the pain, right? And as we all know, no, none of the Sahaba, as we know, astaghfirullah, I mean, none of them ever did this, right? It's ridiculous, unmanly, it is un-Islamic. Qusman is committing suicide on the battlefield because of an arrow. And so immediately the man came back and informed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam what happened. And of course, yani this affirmed their iman that he predicted Qusman is going to go to the fire of hell. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Inna Allah la yu'ayyidu hadha ad-deena bir-rajul al-fajir." Sometimes Allah helps this religion through an evil man. Qusman helped us, but he's an evil man. Qusman helped us, he's fighting on our side, but he is an evil man. And two more very small stories. The first story is this, or the second to last story, is the story of Al-Usayrim Amr ibn Thabit. Al-Usayrim Amr ibn Thabit. Al-Usayrim was one of the very few remaining pagans. Now, this is a bit problematic for me because Ibn Ishaq says that after the Battle of Badr, anybody who was pagan converted to Islam. Yet here we find Usayrim is one of the last pagans. So Allahu A'lam, the way we reconcile this is to say that after the Battle of Badr, any who was pagan in Medina, by and large they converted, but maybe a handful, one or two or three, had remained behind. But there was no community of pagans, and there was no public idol being worshipped. Allah knows best. This is the only way to reconcile. That we now know that Usaydim is still not a Muslim, but he's not a munafiq. Right? He's not a Yahudi. So this means that there were still a handful of pagans, but perhaps we can interpret Ibn Ishaq's statement as being by the time Badr takes place, there are no idols being worshipped, that idolatry as a system is now gone. And this is the only way to reconcile. There are still a few people left. Usayrim is one of them. So Usayrim is still a pagan, and on the day of Uhud, he goes and he sees the city completely dead. Because he's not going to fight. He doesn't want to fight with the Muslims. Sees the whole city dead. So he says, "Where is Sa'd ibn Mu'adh?" This was their up and coming leader. And, you know, he is our basically big guy. "Where is Sa'd ibn Mu'adh?" The woman said, "He's at Uhud." So he said, "Where is so-and-so at Uhud? Where is so-and-so at Uhud?" Every one of the people that he used to look up to, they're all at Uhud. So this was when he realized, this is a powerful force. If all of my friends or colleagues or peers or leaders, all of them are fighting at Uhud, surely there must be a reason. And so Usayrim accepted Islam on Saturday morning, the 15th of Shawwal, the morning of Uhud. He accepts Islam right then and there. And he takes his armor and sword, and he tells his family, who are still pagan apparently at the time, he tells them that, "If I die, my money will go to the Prophet ﷺ. My money will go to Rasulullah ﷺ." And he walks to Uhud, and the Muslims, when they see him, they say, "Ilayka anna, get away from us, what are you doing here?" So they recognize that he's still a pagan. "Get away from here, we're not going to let you fight with us." So Usayrim said, "I have accepted Islam." And so they allowed him to fight, and he died a shaheed in the Battle of Uhud. And obviously, the Battle of Uhud is taking place early morning, so he accepts Islam after Fajr. Dhuhr time has not yet come in, and so he does not even pray one salah. Right? And the Prophet ﷺ said, "عَمِلَ قَلِيلًا وَأَجْرُهُ كَثِيرٌ." He did very little, but his ajr is a lot. And Abu Huraira would test his students by saying, "Who is that Muslim who entered Jannah without doing one sajda?" Of course, we know the answer, but Abu Huraira would test his students. "Who is that Muslim who entered Jannah without making one salah?" Right? And the answer is Usayrim. And of course, if somebody says that, how can you say that the one who leaves the salah is not a Muslim, whereas Usayrim did not pray? We say, of course, Usayrim was never required to pray. because Dhuhr time never came in.
Right.
Had Dhuhr time come in, he would have prayed. So the issue of static salah doesn't apply to Usaydim. Usaydim is not leaving the salah. Usaydim never had the opportunity to pray. He never did one sajda in his life. And yet Allah gave him the shahada. And Allah guides whom He wills. Allah Azza wa Jalla chooses to guide whom He wills. And subhanAllah, how many of us even have heard of non-Muslims who accepted the shahada on their deathbed? How many of us have heard of people that right at the very end, Allah Azza wa Jalla knows that they are deserving and they accept Islam right before their death? And the final story, and then inshallah we will conclude. And I apologize about the length, but I wanted to start with the Prophet ﷺ. That's a whole separate issue of Uhud, what happened with him. The final story that we know is a very small, very quick story, Mukhayriq. Mukhayriq is his name. We don't know much about him at all. All that we know, Mukhayriq, with a qaf, Mukhayriq, was of the Jewish tribes of Medina. And Mukhayriq, on the day of Uhud, told his people. Now, the Prophet ﷺ had not approached the Yahud for help in his own wisdom, because he knew they're not going to help him. Technically, they're supposed to help, because that was the treaty, the very beginning, the constitution, that if we are attacked externally, we will fight as one. Correct? In his wisdom, he didn't even bother asking, because he knows the answer is going to be a no. Right? And this also shows us tensions are developing. This also shows us situation is getting very sour. And as we know, this is a constant source between the Prophet and the Yahud. And so he didn't even ask them. Mukhayriq was the one who kept on trying to incite them to go and help. He said, "You know that it is our duty to help Muhammad." Not Rasulullah, because he's not a Muslim. To help Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's our duty. He took an ahd from us. And they kept on, you know, belittling him until finally they said, finally when it's Saturday, what are they going to say? Just the Saturday, right? So the very end is like still trying, goes, today is the Sabbath, we cannot do anything, right? So basically he got irritated at his own people. He said, yani, you know, la sabta lakum, may you have no Sabbath, you know, after this. And then he took his armor and his sword just to be faithful to the treaty, not as a Muslim. He felt that this is our obligation and duty. We took a promise that we're going to fight together. And so he took his armor and sword, and he also said to his people that if I die, my property will go to the Prophet ﷺ, not to Muhammad, he said, and not to any of you, because you're not fulfilling your promise. And he fought a brave battle, and he died in the Battle of Uhud, defending the Muslims, not out of deen, but out of loyalty to a common treaty. And that is why the Prophet ﷺ praised him, as he praised Mut'im ibn Adi, but a much less praise because he's not Mut'im, but he praised him as well. And he said, Mukhayriq khayru Yahud. That Mukhayriq is the best of all the Jews. Mukhayriq is the best of all the Jews. He fulfilled his promise to us. And this shows us, as I talked about Mut'im ibn Adi and others, that it is a part of our Islamic etiquette and culture that we praise anybody who deserves praise, Muslim or non-Muslim. We honor them, we show them dignity, we give them prizes, we invite them to our lectures and conferences. Not a problem at all, unlike some of the more, you know, extreme or fundamentalist people amongst us. Nothing wrong with this. The Prophet is honoring Mukhayriq, is honoring Mut'im, and he says, Mukhayriqu khayru Yahud. He is the best of all the Jews because he fulfilled his promise. And inshallah, with this, we will stop here and then continue, inshallah, next Wednesday.